those two areas together, you can then produce quite a nice, simple quantitative model, a qualitative model, which is linking things like large Pacific fish to squid, to small pelagic fish, down to micronecton, zooplankton, phytoplankton, nutrients, down to southwest currents. You can put all those in a quite simple model, and that allows you to define which parts of the system you need to measure if you're going to measure the impact of a threat affecting a value. And so that really collapses that whole old question of what you should measure. It really keys in on why you want to measure particular aspects of the system. I have a couple of my moments, so I just thought I'd kind of revisit this discussion from before, and just because it does lead to monitoring. We've mentioned that recovery rates in the deep sea will be very slow. You've seen this earlier slide of the trawled versus the untrawled area. There's a nice untrawled area, and there's totally trawled area. The idea that we went back in 10 years later to look at that area, and there was no signs of recovery. So how long will deep sea recovery take? So it will be often slow. Often, if we're interested in monitoring that period of recovery after mining has ceased, we might be there for 100 years. So what mechanism would be there to have the companies engaged in monitoring 100 years after they finish mining? I expect it to be quite a difficult mechanism. There are mechanisms that can be used, bonds and things like that. But I think another key question which we need to look at when setting up monitoring is, will this monitoring actually affect management activities? You know, if we're monitoring for the sake of it, and there's actually no way it's going to affect the management we're doing, no, it's not going to affect any of our current activities, then I think we have to ask why we're doing it. It's kind of interesting. We can show mining was good, bad, or indifferent, but it's actually not going to affect how that mining occurs, then why are we doing it? So I think that's another way to kind of focus the monitoring. And I just put this up because this is our first deep water MPA monitoring site where we were short of technology, so we took advantage of the United States vessel coming down, one time with a ROV, one time with an AUV, and we took the advantage to time to survey this particular area, very precisely referenced. We've got maps of coral communities on here. This one, an impacted area with much less, fewer coral communities. And we've put down settlement plates so that we can revisit this area in 10, 20 years' time and understand how that deep sea community is changing. I guess the point is that here, the technology available, at least in the United States, not Australia at the moment, to start doing some of this deep water monitoring in a very rigorous way. We just have to kind of work out what the questions are. And I think that going back to the EBSAs actually provide a way, having that kind of internationally agreed set of values to which we could look at particular areas and say, these are the particular values of a key area, and having identified those values, we can then identify how the threat of mining is likely to affect those values and then come up with key sets of simpler parts of that system which need to be monitored. I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. And I think we might have time for a question or comment from the floor. Anyone wants to be a taker? If not, then we will move on. We need a lot of time later on in the day. So, Samantha, please. Thank you very much, Nick. I think on behalf of everyone, and Samantha, it's your turn to update us now with the Nautilus Minerals Solwara 1 project.
Can I walk and talk? Okay, thank you, Russell. I'm giving a bit of a Solwara 1 update, but also going back and looking at what we've done previously, just based on some of the questions that I've heard in the last couple of days. I think there's probably some value in going back and looking at the process that was followed to get our environmental permit. Now, some of you have seen this slide already, but once you start working for a publicly listed company, you do need to start with a slide like this. I'm not going to read it all now or I'm going to run out of time. You're welcome to look at it afterwards, but it basically says that what I'm telling you today is to the best of our knowledge true, but please bear in mind things can and do change. Okay, so we've heard a lot already from a number of different speakers about why we're thinking about going to the sea. One of the reasons is that land resources are becoming more and more stretched, and yet the world's demand for minerals and metals continues to rise, and that's particularly true with the industrialization of countries like China and India. We've also heard a number of people say that every human activity impacts on the environment in one way or another, and if we're going to be responsible citizens of this planet, then we need to think about ways to minimize the impacts of our activities. And seafloor production might be one way to do that in terms of limiting the activity or limiting the impact of extracting minerals from the earth. So Nautilus is the first company to commercially explore the seafloor for seafloor massive sulfide deposits. One thing we really like about these is that they contain high grades of copper, gold, zinc, and silver. The other thing we like is that if you go down to the seafloor with a camera, this is what you see, and this is the deposit, which means there isn't a lot of overburden that needs to be removed to get to that deposit. Going back to this slide for a minute, those of you who are from Papua New Guinea might recognize this mine site. Not only was a hole dug to get to the ore, but a mountain was also removed. And as Robert pointed out earlier, once mountains are removed, they don't tend to come back anytime soon. So that's one advantage of going down to the sea. So the high grades combined with the minimal overburden mean that we have the chance to have a project with a much smaller physical footprint than its land-based counterparts. And of course, we also have minimal social disturbance because there's nobody living in the deep sea. And so nobody needs to be relocated for the production to commence. So as most of you know, our first project is called Solawara 1. For those of you who don't know, Solawara is Tok Pisin for saltwater. And there's 1,600 meters of saltwater above the proposed extraction site. Solawara 1 is 30 kilometers from the nearest coast, and it involves a small extraction area of about 0.11 kilometers squared. So just to set the scene a little bit, Solawara 1 contains 5 mineralized zones. And in keeping with the comment Ray Binns mentioned yesterday that Nautilus has come in and had some very inventive naming, so taken names like Roman ruins, et cetera, and turned them into a Solawara with a number, we've done the same here. So what used to be called Williamson, Binns, Payne, Scott, and Kowalczyk, I think I've remembered that fairly correctly. These are now known as Far West, West, Central, East, and Far East. So in keeping with our ingenious naming strategy, there you go. Solawara 1 is a weekly active hydrothermal vent site. The geos tell me that it's weekly, or it's a waning system. It is near an active subsea volcano called North Su. And South Su is a hydrothermal vent site located on the other side of that volcano, which is a reference area, which has already been mentioned today. Okay, so what does seafloor production look like? Okay, well, it starts with cutting up ore on the seafloor, and I think it was Charles Morgan, he showed this picture already yesterday. The ore and the seawater go up the pipe to a ship. The ore is separated from seawater on board the ship. Seawater is filtered and discharged back to the deep sea where it came from. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. That wasn't the first project description that we had. The ore is put onto a barge and taken for temporary storage. And when there's enough ore collected, the ore is then taken to a pre-existing processing plant overseas. So one thing to remember for phase one of the project, which is this, is that there will be no processing or tailings within Papua New Guinea or within the South Pacific. The little M's and O's, I don't know if you can see them, but they sort of let you know where some of the technology comes from. So the seafloor production tools actually come from the already operating offshore mining or diamond mining industry or dredging industry. The pump and the riser come from the oil and gas industry, and the new thing about this project really is putting those two technologies together. In terms of approvals, we started by looking at what other mining and oil and gas companies had done, and we recognized early on that there were at least two types of approvals that you needed to get for a project to proceed. One has a legal basis, which has a fairly set number of rules and steps that you need to follow. And then there's this other thing called a social license, which is a general approval or acceptance from concerned stakeholders. In terms of the legal process, Sawara 1 is governed by two principal pieces of legislation in Papua New Guinea, the Mining Act 1992, which governs the exploration, development, processing, and transportation of minerals, and includes the seabed as land, which was mentioned earlier by one of our colleagues. The Environment Act 2000 outlines the environmental requirements of an activity, and any mining operation, just so you know, requires an EIS, which also takes into account social considerations. One thing that's quite good about this framework, and I'll go into it in a bit more detail later, is that it does account for the different project phases. So the different project phases are summarized here. One is the first stage is really an exploration stage, and that's about finding out what's there. And what we're looking at is resource, so what's there in terms of resource, but also what's there in terms of the environment. This is a low impact activity. It's very similar to marine scientific research activities. In fact, if you looked at pictures of the equipment that we use and pictures of the equipment the scientists use, it looks very, very similar. Sometimes it's the same. Feasibility phase is where you're doing your environmental impact statement putting together your project feasibility documentation. And this is where you get into a bit more detail. So here you're defining the project, the impacts, as well as the benefits. And then when you get to extraction, this is the higher impact activities. So this is the environmental regulatory framework from Papua New Guinea. The Department of Environment and Conservation kindly gave me this slide. And what they look at in terms of the permitting requirements is the level of impact an activity has. So level one would be a marine scientific research cruise would be considered a level one activity. In fact, drilling up to a cumulative depth of 2,500 meters is still considered a level one activity. So whilst there's no environmental permit required for a level one activity, there are several environmental guidelines and codes of practice that need to be followed. A level two activity, an example of a level two, is a drilling program which has a cumulative drill depth of 2,500 meters or more. In this case, you don't need to do an environmental impact assessment, but you do need to have an environmental permit application that outlines the project and its expected impacts. You then issued an environmental permit that has a number of conditions associated with it, including sampling and ongoing monitoring. As I mentioned, any mining activity is considered a level three activity, and that kicks off an environmental impact assessment process, which culminates in an environmental impact statement, which must be submitted to the government for approval. Charles talked about the importance of scoping, and that's, again, something I like about the PNG process, is that you, before you start your environmental impact assessment, you submit something called an environmental inception report, which outlines your project, the anticipated impacts, all the studies that you plan to do to describe the environment and assess impacts, and who will do those studies. That needs to be approved before you can go on to write up your EIS and do your EIA. Once the environmental impact statement is complete, it's submitted to the government. It goes through an assessment. In our case, the EIS was reviewed by a consultant group that was based in Australia that was engaged by the Department of Environment and Conservation. After about 6 months, it was about a six-month review process, the EIS was then approved. It then goes to the minister for their approval. At that stage, once the EIS receives its approval in principle, then you're invited to submit an environmental permit application. And then if that's successful, you get an environmental permit. Something that's important to note is that an environmental management and monitoring plan must be submitted and approved before operations can commence, but it is not part of the EIS in the Papua New Guinea process. Okay, so the general environmental impact assessment objectives are to define the existing environment, estimate impacts of the project to the environment, develop strategies to minimize those impacts, and effectively, it integrates the social, economic, and environmental factors into a sustainable development proposal. When the government is making decisions about the EIS, what they're really doing is balancing the impacts versus the benefits. And the benefits need to outweigh the impacts in order for the project to be able to succeed. And I've put here site-specific simply because there's not one EIS out there that's going to cover every case. It really needs to be a case-by-case decision-making tool. environmental impact assessments today really are a test of a project's legitimacy. More weight is placed now on social license. It involves taking on board a diverse set of values and opinions. A multi-stakeholder approach really is required for success, and that includes talking to anti-developmental NGOs or civil society groups, as they're preferring to be called, and that includes both local and international groups. And at the end of the day, what people think matters, and it is important if you want to be a company that accounts for the triple bottom line, you do need to look after the social, the environment, as well as the economic. So remember what I said about Sawara 1, it's a weakly active hydrothermal vent system. And when you say hydrothermal vents, that kind of site has value for certain people. And value means different things to different people. So if you're a geologist, maybe you think of a hydrothermal vent site and think, you know, this could be a puzzle working out how did this form, or, you know, maybe it's a deposit. If you're a biologist or perhaps somebody who's seen a lot of Discovery Channel or IMAX films, maybe you're thinking of giant tube worms or Charles's shirt. And maybe you're thinking of ecological value or something to protect. Engineers may see it as a challenge. A host country might see a source of income, which ultimately leads to schools, hospitals, roads, et cetera, and other infrastructure. Maybe they see it as a source of employment. A company sees probably copper, gold, zinc, and silver, and a lot of it. Obviously, they do see an income, but they might also, in the case of Nautilus, at least see a chance to make a difference. Conservationists and NGOs, maybe they too see an ecological value, or maybe they see a cause. And the general public are looking at all of these different points of view and probably thinking, well, who do we believe, and well, do we actually need this project anyway? So all those types of views and values need to be taken into account as you move forward and work towards getting this thing called a social license to operate. And on the simplest sense, we have to start by thinking about, well, what are we seeking acceptance for? And in, again, the simplest sense, we're looking to disaggregate material on the seafloor down here, transport that material to a ship, and then transport that material to market. What you're seeing here is a picture developed, or a production system developed after years and years and years of thought. This didn't always look like this, as those of you who have heard me talk over the years know. And the important thing to remember is that each one of these steps can be done a number of different ways, and each one of those different ways can have a different environmental and possibly social impact. Okay, so when or how you decide how to go forward, you know, really does matter what the approach is that you take. So early on in the piece, we thought, right, well, how are we going to go forward? We know we want to do these three things: cut up material, bring it to a ship, take it to market. And we thought, well, we need to do a little bit of risk assessment here. What are people going to care about? What are values that people are going to hold? We did some stakeholder mapping. Obviously, hydrothermal vent ecologists became part of that list. And we thought, well, look, this is something that is quite new. We do need to go beyond legal compliance, and we do need to take a precautionary approach. We also felt it important to take a multi-stakeholder approach, and we thought, well, at the base of it all, we've got to get the science right. So our approach was to have early, transparent, and inclusive stakeholder engagement. We did hold a number, and still hold a number, of multi-stakeholder workshops, which involve community members, world-renowned experts in various fields, from anthropologists to hydrothermal vent ecologists to other marine scientists, governments, as well as international and locally based NGOs as well. And this is the approach we took to design our EIS, to help design the number of studies and the types of studies we needed to do to help us carry out which studies we needed to do. When the studies were finished, we went back to a multi-stakeholder approach to review all those studies together so that we could look at the system and environment holistically. And together, again, we developed mitigation strategies. So all the way through, we have relied on the expertise of others to help us make decisions going forward. Today we have ongoing community awareness and consultations, and in February we will be having a multi-stakeholder workshop to write or help develop our environmental management and monitoring plans. We also established something called CARES, which stands for Community Accountable, Responsible, Environmentally, and Safe. A lot of companies call this their HSEC program or something similar. It also has its own website, and on that website you can find our environmental impact statement plus all of the supporting studies. And you can also find information about our latest community awareness, the questions we've been asked, the kind of responses we've had, and the commitments that we've made. Really, this slide just shows the different processes in the EIS, or the different steps in the EIS process, and the different ways that we engaged along the way. So some of the studies that were identified, and this has a deep sea focus, so forgive me for that. This is not an exhaustive list. But these were the studies that were identified and conducted. And our additional objective was going out to the sea with a ship and an ROV. You've heard already today a few times, it's pretty expensive to go out there. And I thought, well, we want to make the best of it. And we had an additional objective that science would also benefit from the additional deep sea studies that we were conducting to obtain data for our EIS. And it was a genuine desire of ours to contribute to the scientific knowledge of the deep sea. So take scientists out with you on a ship, and all of a sudden a lot of people out there will say, well, they weren't independent. But we thought, well, if you don't use the best, who do you use? And one way to get around that was to give those researchers freedom to publish. Okay, so people are free to publish their work. I've been told that that's not that common for development projects. Independent reviewers did review the EIS. We asked a group of peers of the people who wrote our EIS to come in and review it, and the DEC, as I mentioned, engaged an independent consultant from Australia to review it as well. We also are, you know, very keen to be transparent, and as I mentioned already, our EIS and all the supporting studies are on the website. So what did we find in the environmental in process? Some defining features of Solora 1. One, it's small scale. It's 0.11 kilometers squared. That's, yeah, pretty small area on the seabed. As Robert mentioned earlier, it avoids land clearance activities compared to typical land-based mining. There's no construction of haul roads, no removal of trees, minimal overburden or waste removal. There's no toxic chemicals used in the mining process. That's a commitment we've made to the people of PNG. No blasting is needed for this type of production. Infrastructure can be reused and relocated. So when mining finishes at one site, the tools can come up to the ship and the ship can sail off to the next site. And as I've mentioned already, there's no direct impact to communities. So what does it look like on the seafloor? Well, as I mentioned, it's a weakly active hydrothermal vent system. And there's active and dormant areas. So at the active sites, these are the biomass dominant species that are there. So there's two types of snails, the hairy snail and the black snail, and a type of barnacle. I should mention that all of the studies that were conducted at Solora 1 were also conducted at South Sioux, which is that reference area I mentioned earlier. And the same main habitat zones exist at both sites. In terms of the dormant sites, the biomass dominant species are keratoises, stock barnacles, and hydroids. And again, we conducted the same studies at Solora 1 and South Sioux, and no significant difference between samples taken from Solora 1 and South Sioux with respect to the numerically dominant species was present. What else did we find out? That venting activity is variable. So this map, which I keep promising to update, and I haven't yet, shows in purple and blue dots the different areas where venting was noticed between 2006 and 2007. We have been back since in 2008 and 2010, so I'll also update this map for next time. But we continue to see changes of where areas have turned on and off and then off and on. As Chuck mentioned earlier today, some animals need that heat in order to survive, and so if a vent turns off, the snails don't like it too much, and this is what we see a lot of at Solora 1 is piles of dead snails. What this means is when you have a system that's quite naturally variable, you must have animal communities that are adapted to or at least tolerant of the variability, and as Chuck mentioned, it's not the individuals that will be, obviously, that will be adapted to that change, but the populations themselves must be, otherwise they wouldn't have survived or still be there. Some other things to remember is that near vents, ambient baseline concentration of metals exceed water quality guidelines, and that's because those vents are emitting very, very metal-rich fluids. plumes do occur naturally. Hopefully you remember I mentioned an active subsea volcano. That plume does half of the time spend its time over Sawar 1, the other half of the time spend its time over Celsu, which again works quite well with Celsu being a reference site. Plumes are also occurring from the hydrothermal vents themselves. Because of the volcano in particular, but also contributing to it are the hydrothermal vents, we've got a naturally high sedimentation rate. This slide summarizes the impacts. This is another one that need to update at some point. The listed impacts are the same, but we've just got to add three of these, and the geologists keep telling me that needs to be a little bit more of a mound, the Sawara one. Okay, so we talked already about the steps, so you're cutting up ore down here. And what's going to happen as a result of doing that is you might get some plumes from cutting, but as Robert mentioned, one of the ways to avoid that is to cut and suck at the same time, which means that all the fines are going into the hose attached to the seafloor production tool. And then if anything's going to drop, it should be the larger particles. The other thing that's going to happen, and this was mentioned at least by Charles Morgan, but others, was it you, Charles? You are going to have material and habitat removal, and that is true for this project as it is for any mining project and most development projects. And of course, you do also have some light and noise impacts. Okay, going up, I will come back to this, but going up the riser, in the midwater column, you have the presence of a riser pipe. Now, this is one of those areas where we had a choice of different ways that we could bring the ore to the surface. And what we've chosen to do is have a fully enclosed ore delivery system to minimize impacts to the midwater column and to the surface waters. When you get to the production support vessel of the surface, the potential impacts, or the impacts are lighting, noise, routine discharges, which are governed by international legislation, as well as Papua New Guinea legislation and international legislation such as MARPOL apply. And of course, it is the presence of a ship and some supporting vessels, which of course are similar to shipping and exploration surveys. As I mentioned, the ore gets dewatered on the PSV, and that water is then filtered and put back down here. Now, in the EIS, we committed to discharging that water and filtering it to 8 microns. So a micron is about 1/1000th of a meter big, so 8 of those. We think we can actually even do better than that. One of the reasons we want to is because the grade is so high, we don't actually want to put anything back down if we can help it, but there are technical limitations to that. So this water here will come down. Now, you might not even see it. I have seen a few containers with the same density and amount of material in it. It does look clear. But that will be an impact to this water, to this water area. One of the things that we changed about the project description was we originally thought about discharging in the midwater column. Now, we never considered discharging at the surface. We always thought it needed to be below the light zone or productive zone. But in consultation with communities who were still concerned that this might cause problems with fisheries and tuna, we went back to the engineers and said, look, is it possible to put this water back where it came from? And the engineers said, well, it's actually interesting you talked to us about that, because we were looking at potentially discharging that water to help drive this water coming up. So there was another, engineering and environmental advantage to doing it. And it was only a few weeks later, the project description had changed. They'd worked out a way to make it happen. Okay, so in terms of limiting those impacts on the seafloor, our mitigation strategies were developed with a team of world experts. Just so you know, none of those experts were paid. They were simply invited to give us their advice. All the strategies developed all the strategies that were suggested were accepted by Nautilus, and some of the protection measures include setting an area aside, which has already been mentioned. We also have no intention of developing the active subsea volcano, so the area that effectively isn't going to be touched is quite big compared to the area that's proposed for mining. We've also proposed to set up temporary refuge areas within Sawara 1 to help the progressive rehabilitation of the site occur. We've also proposed to relocate some animals out of the path of mining and put them back where mining has already taken place.